Good morning, friends of St. Peter's, and thank you so much for joining us for worship today. We are excited that this is Jazz Music Sunday, and so we welcome Beverly Holtz and Adrian Holtz, who are joining our accompanist Paul Holtz in offering some really gorgeous jazz. I know for sure you've already enjoyed a prelude. There's more to come. We hope that you'll like and share this video. Surely you have friends or family or college roommates who would enjoy this service as much as you will. So we hope you'll like and share be the folks we'll hear Paul refer to in Romans as those with beautiful feet who share the good news. You can do that right now by inviting your friends to join us in worship. And also go ahead and click open that bulletin. You'll see the link both on YouTube and on Facebook so that you can sing along and say your parts and help us make this worship together. Our service will continue with Be Thou My Vision after the ringing of the bell.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we who cannot exist without you may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flocks near Shechem, and Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. The man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where they are pasturing the flock." The man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hands, saying, "Let us not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels, carrying gum, balm, and resin, on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. When some midnight traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver, and they took Joseph to Egypt. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in reading the psalm responsively by whole verse. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works.
Glory is his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Search for the Lord and his strength. Continually seek his face.
Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen.
Then he called for a famine in the land and destroyed the supply of bread.
He sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave.
They bruised his feet in fetters, his neck they put in an iron collar.
Until his prediction came to pass, the word of the Lord tested him.
The king sent and released him. The ruler of the people set him free.
He set him as a master over his household, a ruler over all his possessions.
To instruct his princes according to his will and to teach his elders wisdom.
Hallelujah. A reading from St. Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that come from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As we gather hearts together, as we listen to your word, help us know, oh God, your presence. Let our hearts and minds be stirred. Nourish us with sacred story till we claim it as our own. Teach us the
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking towards them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. He said, come. So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink. He cried out, Lord, save me. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, you of little faith, why did you doubt? When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I pray that God's word is spoken and that God's word is heard. Amen. I want to share an image with you that has been with me this week. This image of this stone outside of the Lorraine Motel, where the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. And notice these words inscribed. Behold, here cometh the dreamer. Let us slay him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. Hearing that incredible passage from Genesis, and knowing that this was inscribed outside the Lorraine Motel, it's been really with me, present with me about this amazing truth that if a dream is from God, it cannot die. If a dream is from God, it cannot die. That's the promise that we hear over and over in our incredible readings this weekend, that if a dream is from God, it cannot die. And I have to say, this reading from Genesis is a doozy. This whole part of Genesis is sometimes called the novella, and it really serves to locate the children of Israel in Egypt so that they can then be liberated from slavery. We have to figure out how they got there, right? And this tells that story. But it also tells this incredible story that if a dream is from God, it cannot die. And we see through this incredible story of radical family dysfunction that God can even work in that situation. And we've been seeing generations of family dysfunction this summer in these readings, these readings from Genesis. Goodness. Over and over, we've heard how sibling rivalry, competing for parents' loyalty, parents not trusting God's provision, taking things into their own hands, more sibling rivalry has led to just a horrible, horrible tragedy of generational trauma through this family. This family that is supposed to be the family that brings God's salvation to the whole world. And that alone should give us hope that if God can work through this family, God can work through our families, God can work through us. Because when a dream is from God, it cannot die. Even these dreams, and we printed them for you in the bulletin, even though they weren't assigned to be read, we printed the missing verses from Genesis that unpack some of the dreams. So I hope you'll take some time later to read them. It's kind of no wonder Joseph's brothers had no patience for him. That's not excusing their behavior, but you can see at least why they were cross with him. Because his dreams are, from their perspective, kind of obnoxious, and his behavior is rather obnoxious. And tattling on them and talking to them about how they're gonna be bowing to him, it's a bit over the top. And what is more over the top, however, is their betrayal of Joseph. That they are willing first to kill him, or leave him to die. Even Reuben, who starts to look like he might be a hero to rescue Joseph, is really doing it for his own reasons, to curry favor from their father, not out of any brotherly love for Joseph. And so when we get to the part of the story where Joseph or Judah says, you know, let's not kill him, let's sell him. It's just astonishing how their instinct towards violence out of a sense of scarcity, a sense of competition, a sense of us versus them. It's so deeply ingrained in who they are. And they make this incredibly devastating choice to sell Joseph into slavery. And the layers of this sort of generational trauma are seen in this very reading itself. If you listen closely, as Nicola read, or if you read it closely, you'll see even the language used around names is different and lays out the generational trauma. We hear, I think this is probably because we have different communities in the ancient world telling this story about Joseph. And sometimes they're calling Jacob Jacob, and sometimes they're calling Jacob Israel. Sometimes they're calling the people that Joseph was sold to Ishmaelites. Sometimes they're calling those people Midianites. Those terms are not interchangeable. They both refer to peoples descended from Abraham. You may remember Ishmael was the father of his own nation. Midian is also a child of Abraham. These are all children of Abraham, including these dastardly brothers and Joseph. Are all children of Abraham. Why are they not all called Abrahamites? Because of this generational trauma and this insidious us versus them mentality that is made manifest over and over and over in this family, so that we now have Ishmaelites and Midianites the descendants through Isaac's line who become eventually the Israelites in this story. So we see that pain over and over and over again. And we do hear that God does not miss this opportunity. I don't think that God inflicted this intentionally, but God is one to not let an opportunity pass. As our bishop pointed out to us early in the pandemic, that she doesn't believe that God wrought the pandemic upon us, but God will not waste this opportunity and is willing to work with us and work in the church in new ways because of this difficult situation that we're in. And I think God similarly is willing to work through this painful situation for God's greater good, for God's dream to come true. And we hear some of that dream unfolding in the psalm that we prayed together, as well as the Joseph story continues, and we'll continue it again next week. It will culminate. I encourage you actually to go ahead and read through the whole story. Keep reading to the end of Genesis, actually, so that when you hear it next week, you kind of know all the crazy stuff that happens to Joseph in between when he ends up in Egypt. It's really quite the page turner, actually. But God's dream, when the dream is from God, God's dream will not die. That's the promise that we see played out in Joseph's story. And it's the promise that we hear and see lived out through the disciples in this incredible gospel passage that we heard this morning as well. A beautiful and beloved passage of, sometimes we call it Jesus walking on the water, sometimes we call it Peter walking on the water, sometimes we make jokes that Peter, the rock, sinks like a stone on the water. This incredible, incredible story that actually appears in three gospels, but probably not the three that you're thinking right now. Usually when we say, a story shows up in three gospels, we think, well, it must be the synoptics. It must be Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But actually, it's Matthew, Mark, and John. Luke does not include this story for some reason, does not include this story in his rendering of the gospel. But the difference between Matthew and Mark is this beloved piece about our patron saint, Peter. And it helps, again, as Reverend Martha used the term of ground truthing the story, it helps to remind ourselves again how we got here. So we had the murder of John the Baptist. We had the disciples and Jesus getting this news and trying to go someplace so they could grieve, trying to find a place of respite so they could just be present to their sorrow. But before they can do that, the crowds find them. And despite their exhaustion, ocean and being on such low reserves, Jesus says, hey, disciples, you feed them. It's a fun distinction between Matthew and John's gospel, how Jesus says, hey, disciples, you got it. You've got this one. You can do this. And they do, incredibly. After all that, they still have not had time to rest. Every time they think they're going to have a moment to rest, more is asked of them, which is a familiar experience, I think, to all of us now as we've been moving along in this pandemic. Every time we think we're going to catch a break or get some rest, more is asked of us. So we can feel them in that boat. Jesus says, go on ahead, I'll catch up. And he dismisses the crowds. And finally, Jesus gets to go off and pray. And what happens to the disciples? They find themselves in a storm. There is no rest for these disciples. And so indeed, they find themselves in the midst of the chaos of the water, which pay attention. Every time you see a body of water in scripture, it's significant. And it almost always ends up signifying the chaos of creation when a storm is present. Think about how God's control over the waters in the creation story, the flood, the coming parting of the Red Sea, all these stories of God controlling the force of water. Well, that's what's happening here again. We have the chaos of a Galilean storm, and these storms appear and emerge in the Sea of Galilee out of nowhere, still to this day, because of the geologic formations around this large lake. Storms can come up in the blink of an eye, and that's what happens with these disciples. It's also helpful for us to remember, we might assume, okay, a bunch of them were fishermen. They probably knew how to swim. That is a very anachronistic take on this. That's us reading our own assumptions back into the text. In the ancient world, very few people knew how to swim, and it was a very rare person who knew how to swim. So here they are on the boat. Here's Peter about to go step out on the water. And it's very likely that they were not swimmers. Very, very likely. And so having all of that knowledge, we come to this incredible story where they wake up and it's actually not the storm that's frightening them, although they may be utterly, shatterly exhausted. It's not until they see Jesus and think he's a ghost that they become afraid. And Peter's reaction is fascinating. They cry out in fear. Jesus says, take heart, it's I, do not be afraid. And going back to creation again, it is I. That is that ego a me. That is another I am statement that Jesus makes. The one who is in the beginning with creation identifies God's self that way, right? I am that I am. Take heart, it is I am, do not be afraid. And Peter's response is, Lord, if it is you, command me to come out on the water. What an astonishing reaction. You know, Peter doesn't say, Lord, if it is you, calm the sea. If it is you, ask me to do this crazy thing and walk out there with you. And it seems like Peter's really putting Jesus to the test, which we know we're not supposed to do. He's sort of demanding a sign, even though we just had this incredible act of Jesus in the feeding of the 5,000 through them. And he makes this demand on Jesus. If it's you, prove it. Command me to come out on the water. And Jesus goes there with him. Come. So Peter gets out of the boat and he starts walking on water and he's moving towards Jesus. And then despite everything, he forgets all the wonder of this miracle that he's now experiencing, the wonder of the miracle that just happened. And the winds cause him to be afraid and he begins to sink like that rock. Then he cries out, Lord, save me. And Jesus immediately reaches out his hand and catches him and says, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? These are such important verses, these final verses that precede the proclamation, this faith proclamation of the disciples in the boat, "You're the Son of God," which is a remarkable thing for them to say in these circumstances. It's not usually the significant proclamation we hear about in this gospel. Usually we leave that up to Peter too, don't we? That comes up later in these chapters. But this interaction with Peter, "Lord, save me. You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" There's a faithfulness in the midst of that, this faithfulness of Jesus meeting Peter right where he is consistently and meeting him when he calls out to him, "Lord, save me." That's the anchor for me. That's why I can trust that a dream that is from God cannot die. It's because of those words. Peter, over and over, you know, testing Jesus, challenging Jesus, doubting Jesus, demanding from Jesus, and Jesus is right there with him the whole way, loving him, never gives up on him, doesn't tell him to take a hike, doesn't let him sink, doesn't, you know, he just loves him and he saves him. He loves him and he saves him. And this phrase, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" I don't hear as a reprimand so much as words said with love. Remember, this is the same gospel that says, if you've got faith as small as a mustard seed, you can do great things, right? You can move mountains. It's not a big problem to have little faith in Matthew's gospel. You might want to keep growing that faith. You don't want to stay there, but great things can happen even if you have little faith. And so Jesus doesn't lose faith in Peter. Jesus trusts that even through Peter, God's dream cannot die. So this is my hope for us. This is my hope that we can trust in this good news that that God loves us no matter what. There's nothing we can do about it. God will always love us, that love is there for us, and that God's dream lived through us cannot die either. God does not give up. God's love does not give up. The peace for us, I believe, is to continue to call on God. "Lord, save me," Peter says in that moment. He comes back to himself and remembers himself and calls on Jesus to save him. And my prayer is that that's where we can be, especially as we find ourselves tired, exhausted, longing for respite and not seeing it in sight, just as those disciples must have felt. And when we get to our wits, when we are short on bandwidth, patience, energy, when exhaustion seems like it's the waters about to come over our heads, that we cry out, "Lord, save me." We call on God, invite God in, invite God to work through us, even in the midst of this circumstance, to make God's dream come true. That's my prayer for us. Because God loves you, I love you. There's nothing you can do to change that. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed together.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And at this time, as we prepare to read the prayers of the people, we invite you to put into the comment stream, the chat stream on both YouTube and Facebook, the birthdays or anniversaries of any of you or your loved ones that you would like to celebrate with us this week. We remember especially this week Rob and Melissa Collins Porter, who are celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary. If there are others, please do put them into the chat stream at this time.
We glory in God's name through the offering of our prayers and petitions, responding,
"Hear us, good Lord."
For the will to discover God's word dwelling in our hearts, finding expression through our lips, and revealing hope through our generosity, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
For a renewed commitment to righteousness and peace, that we may join with the leaders of the nations in seeking ways to promote harmony in warring lands and mutual respect across cultures, races, and languages, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
For creative ways to express the faith, drawing upon the jewels of our tradition, and using our hearts and minds to proclaim Christ's message to those of little faith or who have no faith at all, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That the summer months may provide opportunities for rest and refreshment so that we may be rejuvenated for the challenges ahead, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord. For physicians, nurses, first responders, and all others who minister to the sick and the suffering, granting them wisdom and skill, sympathy and patience, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord. For those who have died and reside in the tomb of death, that Christ, who broke the chains of death, will bring them to eternal life, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
And remembering especially those 7 Marines and 1 sailor who died this past week at the training exercise at Camp Pendleton, and the chaplains serving their families and loved ones. Remembering also those who have perished in Beirut, Lebanon due to the explosion. O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of great sickness, we flee to you for relief and comfort. Deliver us, we beseech you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. Comfort those who mourn or who are in great financial distress. Endue our leaders with wisdom and courage. And grant that perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Children praying.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Take a moment to greet each other in the name of the Lord. If you have two-legged friends or four-legged friends around to share the peace with. And we can say our birthday and anniversary prayer now. So much to celebrate. Let us say it together. Watch over thy servants, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And before we start our offertory sentence today, want to invite your prayers for our beloved Bob Gavuzzi, who is moving to Reno, Nevada, to live with his son and daughter-in-law, family there. And we have a little message from Bob that we would like to share with you right now.
Well, Bob, thank you so much for your willingness to join us this weekend in our services. This is a big time for you and a sad time for us. But we wanted to have a chance to say we love you and to say our farewell and our Godspeed to you. Just for those of you who have, or haven't, the folks who haven't been around St. Peter's as long, how long have you been at St. Peter's, Bob?
I've been here since 1973, which would be 47 years.
Wow. Yeah. 1973. And what would you say is the biggest change you've seen at St. Peter's over those years?
Well, it's rather interesting because I think spiritually one grows with a very loving family that we have here. And so over the years, I've really come to recognize my spiritual realm in a sense. And a combination of things, Priscilla was very big. And when I started here, Tally Jarrett was the rector at the time. And at that time, we were under the Diocese of Los Angeles still. So, and then Father Wallerstorff, Bishop Wallerstorff, became the first bishop. So, and seeing those changes. And I was in the choir for 31 or 32 years, you know, and only dropped out of it because of my hearing situation. But anyway, so that's been a big part of my growth here. But the timing and the love of the parish, who certainly carried me through on a couple memorials for my wife and my son through this parish, it's really a home for me. Yeah. And I attribute my keeping balance in life through the parish love of the families. Mm-hmm. So it's something forever. I remember one of the things that I first came down, the company asked me to move down here to open a branch. I was in the savings loan business in San Bernardino. And my wife and I drove down on a Saturday, and down here where you see the, there was a mobile station, next to it was a cafe called the Surf and Turf Cafe, I believe. So we had breakfast, and I said, oh, we walked around the corner, and we saw a sign, Episcopal Church. We were members of St. John's San Bernardino. So we walked up, and we were standing out on the alley, And this beetle drove up, Volkswagen, and this gentleman stepped out, and then he had some shirts, and he introduced himself, and his name was Robert McKeaton. Well, Robert, we didn't know, he was so friendly talking about the church, and the fact he was dropping his clothes off. So anyway, he spent several minutes telling us all about it, and so we were delighted. Interestingly, Bob McKeaton, the window, St. Helena, Hilda, I believe, in our north transept.
Yeah.
That window is dedicated to Robert McKeaton, but he won an Oscar. He was with the Hollywood film industry, but he won an Oscar for doing the set design for Roots, the movie Roots. Then he also did the Trumbulls, I believe, which was another movie, but that was a highlight. And so there's a lot of history. And my first, when we set the savings and loan, was just opposite the church. It's in a two-story building, and we had the office space in it. And I remember two little ladies came out on a Monday morning down the steps and stuck their heads in, introduced them, said, "What is this?" We told them it's a savings. They were our first customers. And it was Madeline Shippey, which one of the streets is named Shippey Lane, I believe. And I believe her husband was headed up, he was deceased, was the Los Angeles Times or Examiner at the time. He was the editor. Anyway, that was our connection.
Your first connections to St. Peter's. Well, yes. I will always be grateful for your kindness and your love and how generously you share that love. And I will so miss getting those wonderful exchanges, the hugs at the door after the 7:45, or seeing you at the Wednesday service, or just having you pop into the office to say hi. I've been trying to talk Bob out of moving to Reno for about a year. For those of you who are wondering why we're letting this happen, I have been trying to keep him here. But tell us what excites you about going to Reno and being with your family. What are you looking forward to most?
You guess when am I going to be? It's I'll be leaving here the 15th. Is that time-wise? Yeah. And actually, my son and his wife, they want me to move in with them. And guess what? I'm going to do it. They said they've got my room all set up, and they have a den for me with computer, tell all the good things, and I think I'll have everything I need to keep my communication line here at St. Peter's in time.
Oh, good. Counting on that. We're counting on seeing you in social gatherings and formation gatherings, and hope you'll stay worshiping with us at church. And
we're getting through.
Grateful that the current circumstances allow us to stay connected over some distance as well. Hi, Reverend Martha. You're just in time for us to offer a blessing to
Bob. Oh, good.
Thank you.
Well, Bob, the Lord be with you.
And with you.
Gracious God, we give you thanks for your faithful servant, Bob, for the many ways he has been your heart and your hands in and through our community of St. Peter's and beyond. We ask that you bless him as he prepares to move to Reno and join his family there, knowing that he will be a blessing for them and those in his larger community there, just as he has been for us. We ask that you keep him safe, but most of all, help him always to know how deep your love is for him, and that he will always have family and a home here as well. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Reverend Martha, would you like to offer a prayer too?
I would. Oh, gracious God, thank you for your faithful servant, Bob, and his many, many moons with us, his servant's heart, his servant's hands, his servant feet, bringing good news to those who need it most in our world. Thank you for the many gifts that you have shared with us. And may you continue to shine with the love of God and the love of Jesus in your heart as you leave St. Peter's and go to a new home. God bless you. God be with you. God guide you and protect you now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you. Love you all.
Love you too, Bob. Stay in touch.
I will.
We'll miss you.
Godspeed.
Bye-bye.
And so we come to our service, the time in our service for an offertory. We thank you so much for your ongoing generosity to St. Peter's as we continue to do God's work in the world, even while we are working remotely and at times on the campus, but very rarely. You can give several ways. You can use text to give. And the number for that is 858-252-0622. You can go to our website, which is stpetersdelmar.net/give and follow the prompts there. Or you can use the U.S. Postal Service and send your check to St. Peter's Episcopal Church, Post Office Box 336 in Del Mar, California, 92014. And again, thank you so very much. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to God.
Thank you.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And let us say together the general thanksgiving from a New Zealand prayer book at page 14 of our bulletins. God, our Creator, our Center, our Friend, we thank you for our good life, for those who are dear to us, for our dead, and for all who have helped and influenced us. We thank you for the measure of freedom we have and the extent to which we control our lives. And most of all, we thank you for the faith that is in us, for our awareness of you, and our hope in you. Keep us, we pray, thankful and hopeful and useful until our lives shall end. Amen. And the blessing of God, the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love today and always. Amen. Mother Paige has a few announcements before our final hymn.
I do. So indeed, we're going to very much miss Bob Gavuzzi. There is brewing a Zoom gathering with him, a chance for you to let him know how much you love him. Watch your email for us to send out that Zoom link so that you can come to that. We haven't quite set the time and date yet, but do watch over the next couple of days your email for that to come to you. This is the last week of our reflections on the book, The Return of the Prodigal Son. And thank you, Reverend Martha, for bringing this book back to us and giving us a chance to reflect on it in this community. It's been so beautiful. Next week will be time with Mother Paige, and following that, some more information on how the Sacred Ground curriculum is unfolding here at St. Peter's. So I hope you'll join us for that conversation. And we are getting very close to being able to have the thrift shop open, which is so exciting. But one thing that would be tremendously helpful is having some younger volunteers. So if you would be available and fit that category of under 65 and could let Chris Miller know, please do. There's a hyperlink in your electronic bulletin to get you her information. And similarly, our Helping Hands ministry has gone from 4 days to 3 days, in part because for sustainability reasons, with the number of volunteers we have, 3 days is working. And a number of our volunteers right now are going back to school soon. So we hope you'll pray about being the good news, the hands and feet that bring the good news to those who are in need, either by helping us reopen our thrift store, which serves the those in need in this community in such a powerful way, or our Helping Hands ministry, which does as well. So please do hold that in prayer. And we have a very fun, very jazzy Hail to the Lord's Anointed coming up. And thank you again to the Holtz family and Tasha for our music this weekend and this jazz music Sunday. Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
Take away transgression.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.